Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President of the United States, Donald J. Trump.
And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say,
thank you very much. Hello, Dallas. It's great to be with you tonight. Thank you. And I am thrilled to be here, deep in the heart of Texas, where we just opened a beautiful new Louis Vuitton plant. But I'm with the freedom-loving patriots of the Lone Star State. I love it. There has never been a better time to be a proud Texan. And there's never been a better time to be a proud American. There never has. Never has. So I came from a small town, Alvarado, Texas, where we celebrated the incredible revival of American manufacturing, and we opened up some beautiful places. I'll tell you, this place is doing great, and created, in a very short period of time, an extra 1,000 jobs for Texas. Since my election, we've created 775,000 new jobs across your state, including 70,000 Texas manufacturing jobs. They said those jobs had disappeared, didn't they, huh? Hey, man. Our country is once again living by two simple rules: buy American and hire American. The economy is booming, our people are prospering, our country is thriving, and our nation is stronger than ever before. But the more America achieves, the more hateful and enraged these crazy Democrats become. Crazy. They're crazy. They're crazy. At stake in this fight is the survival of American democracy itself. Don't kid yourself. That's what they want. They are destroying this country, but we will never let it happen, not even close. For three straight years, radical Democrats have been trying to overthrow the results of a great, great election. Maybe, maybe the greatest election in the history of our country. And they want to oppose an extreme agenda. They cannot pass it, and they cannot win it at the ballot box. They're not going to win. They're not even going to. They won't come close in 2020. They know it. They know it. They're not going to win it. They say, let's see, what's another idea? What's another idea? How do we win this election? You know, I really don't believe anymore that they love our country. I don't believe it. Crazy Nancy. Think of that. That crazy Nancy, she is crazy. And Shifty Schiff, how about this guy? How about this guy? He makes up my conversation, which was perfect. He makes up my conversation. He sees what I said. It doesn't play well because it was perfect. So he made up a totally false conversation with the Ukrainian president. And we caught him cold. Everybody knew it anyway. See, we did one thing. You always have to do the unexpected. They never thought I'd release the conversation with the Ukrainian president. I want to get him before Congress, and I want to see what he has to say. You know, they say he has immunity. Why would you have immunity for outright fraud? Why do you have immunity? Why? He's a fraud. We're fighting a campaign against leftists, socialists, and globalists who want to return to reckless wars, open borders, rampant crime, and totally disastrous one-way trade deals. We're changing that one around very quickly. They believe America is the world's piggy bank and that your tax dollars should subsidize the economy, military, and defense of every other nation in the world but our own. It's not happening anymore. Our political opposition made its fortune selling out our nation and its citizens, and you know that's what's been happening. And that's why 2016 was so important. And that's why 2020, I can never say it's more important, but you know, it's like the roots of a tree. You plant a baby tree, it's got to catch. Get that extra time. We'll have more tax cuts. We'll have even, I'll tell you what, we have rebuilt our military. What we've done has never been done before. The do-nothing Democrats have betrayed our country, and that great betrayal is over. We are finally again, and we've been doing it now for almost 3 years. Can you believe we've been doing this for 3 years? Can you believe it? I've been a politician for 3 years. I can't believe that. I never thought I'd be called the politician. I don't like it, but it is what it is. But we're finally again putting America first. The radical Democrats want to destroy America as we know it. They want to indoctrinate our children and teach them that America is a sinful, wicked nation. You see that happening all the time. And I know it from personal experience. What they want to teach your kids, not good. They come home, Mommy, Daddy, this is what I learned. And you're going, oh, no, don't tell me. Let's get them into another school fast. They want to disarm law-abiding citizens. They want to take your guns away. And they want to install far-left judges to shred our Constitution. It's not happening. They want to tear down symbols of faith and drive Christians and religious believers from the public square. They want to silence your voices on social media, and they want the government to censor, muzzle, and shut down conservative voices. You know that. If they didn't hate our country, they wouldn't be doing this to our country. They wouldn't be doing it because they know better. They know better. As an example, we're building a great wall along the southern border. And it's going up rapidly. Going up. And you know, 5 years ago, almost every one of them wanted a wall. Until I came along and I said, we're going to build a great wall, because they could never get it done. And then they stopped the funding. They made it almost impossible. Few people would have been able to do what we did. But we got it from here, and we got it from there, and we got it from all over the place. And we're building that sucker right now, and it's having a tremendous effect already. Not easy. Highest level, everything we said it would be. It's moving rapidly. Although the fake news back there, they don't want to talk about it. They don't want to talk about it. Look at all those cameras. You believe it? Look at all those red lights. Don't worry, I won't say anything bad about your network. Because a lot of times I get ready to do a number on these phony networks, and you know, you see those red lights go off. They don't want their viewers to see it, but that's okay. I'm not going to say it tonight. I'm going to say, your legitimate media. I don't actually mean that. But you look at that. But look at all those cameras. You know, that's like the Academy Awards used to be before it failed. You know why it failed? You know why it failed? Because they came after us. That's why it failed. It failed because they had stupid people saying horrible things about us. Stupid. Stupid people. They are stupid people. And their ratings have dropped like a rocket. I love seeing it, I'm telling you. Love it. But no matter how hard they try, they will fail, because the people of Texas and the people of America will never surrender our freedom to those people right there. We will stand strong for family, faith, God, and for country. last week, a very dumb Democrat candidate for president, that's the end of him in this state, pledged to revoke the tax-exempt status of many churches and religious charities. And by the way, that was after, a few weeks ago, he said, excuse me, we're going to take your guns away. That doesn't work well. And I called him right. Remember the flailing arms? Nobody noticed it. I noticed it. The flailer. You remember he was flailing all over the place. I said, why is this guy hot? John Cornyn's going to win so easily, just like Ted Cruz won. He's going to win, no matter what happens. But John Cornyn is not talking about Beto anymore, because Beto, in a few short weeks, got rid of guns and got rid of religion. Those are not two good things in Texas to get rid of. And I will never allow the federal government to be used to punish Americans for their religious beliefs. And I will never allow the IRS to be used as a political weapon, except in the case of myself, where they use it against me. The radical left tolerates no dissent. It permits no opposition. It accepts no compromise. These people are crazy. And it has absolutely no respect for the will of the American people. First, it was the Russia hoax. Then it was the smearing, which continues, that disgraceful, disgusting smearing of a fine man, Justice Kavanaugh. And now they continue the outrageous impeachment witch hunt with nothing. With nothing. They come after me. But what they're really doing is they're coming after the Republican Party, and what they're really, really doing is they're coming after and fighting you, and we never lose. I'm fighting for everyone who believes in the values, traditions, and principles that have made our nation the greatest in the history of the world. And I have to say this, we are far greater now than ever before. You go back 4 years, you go back 7, 6, 8, even you go back into another administration, you go back 10 and 12 years, where were you compared to where you are right now? So we must hold the Democrats accountable for their lies and their corruption. They are corrupt people. And we must show and vote, and we have to go out, and we have to win this election coming up. It's going to be a landslide, and we have to make it a landslide. Today's do-nothing Democrats, they don't do anything. Where's the USMCA? Everybody wants it. The Democrats even want it. And Crazy Nancy won't let anybody vote on it. She's nuts. Today's Democrats believe anyone who opposes them must be crushed. It's not just like, let's win. You know, I have to say this. The Republicans, and I'm not sure I like this because my life hasn't been this way, but the Republicans play a much softer game. They really do. When all of our stars, and we have great stars, when they went to our Speaker of the House at the time, and they asked for subpoenas. Oh, let's take it easy. Let's do it. Okay. I mean, I get that, too. She hands them out like it's cookies. Here, subpoena. I heard a commentator who happens to be standing right there the other day, doesn't like us at all, but said, I've never seen anyone hand out so many subpoenas. I have people getting subpoenas I never heard of. I said, who are those people? Never saw anything like it. It's a disgrace what they're doing to our country. And we became, because of what they do, not the Republicans and not what we've done, because what they've done and what they see, When people come to my office, which is now the Oval Office, which is your office too, presidents, prime ministers, kings, queens, I hate to say it sometimes, dictators, they just don't like to go by that title. They say, sir, congratulations, sir, on what you've done. Congratulations on what you've done. It's incredible. Your economy is the greatest on earth. And let me tell you, if my crooked opponent would have won the election, right now, China would be by far the number one nation from an economic standpoint in the world. We've gone up trillions of dollars. They've gone down trillions of dollars. And we are so far number one, so far, that they'll never catch us if we are smart right here. But the do-nothing Democrats believe anyone who opposes them has to be crushed. They don't want to just beat them. They don't want to just beat them. These are sick people. They want to crush these people. The anger, the hatred. And that any lie or crime or corruption is justified. So Schiff gets up and makes up my statement. He makes it up 100%. And then he said, he didn't speak to the whistleblower. No, we didn't see the whistleblower. And what about the whistleblower? The whistleblower got it all wrong. Who's the whistleblower? Who's the whistleblower? Who is the whistleblower? We have to know. Is the whistleblower a spy? And who is the IG that did this? All he had to do is look at the tape or look at the what they wrote down, the transcribed version of the phone call. Compare that to the whistleblower's account, and you see it had nothing to do with it. So why does the IG allow a thing like this to happen to our country? Why? Why? Got a lot of bad people out there, but one by one, we're advancing. One by one. Just look at the terrible foreign corruption of the Bidens. I hate to talk about him. You know why? I don't think the guy's got a chance. Sleepy Joe, I don't think he's got a chance. I don't see it. I don't know. I've got these great, brilliant senators over here. I have all these congressmen over here. Fellas, I don't think he has a chance. I'd like him to. I'd like him to. You know, I thought Pocahontas was gone, left in embers. You got to give her credit. Those embers, they kept going, going, going. Now it looks like she's doing better. But I don't think Joe has a chance. But did you see the other night where CNN, in a totally unsubstantiated statement, the president said this about you. We're so sorry he said that. His son walked out with $1.5 billion from China. These were not the same Chinese people I just dealt with, I will tell you that. But Joe Biden was in charge of Ukraine policy while his son, with absolutely no energy experience, just got thrown out of the Navy like a dog, was paid massive sums of money by a Ukrainian energy company. You know what that's called? It's called a payoff, folks. He didn't know energy at all, knew nothing about energy. They hired him, paying him massive amounts of money, much more than the $50,000 a month you heard about. That's a lot. That's a lot. But much more. Joe Biden made them go out and fire the prosecutor on tape. But they don't want to show the tape. I had to put it up on my social media site. They don't want to show the tape where he was bragging. They're not going to get this money unless they get rid. And boo, they got rid of the prosecutor. He was investigating the son and the son's company, got rid of them. Now, that's what you call quid pro quo. While these charges are totally unsubstantiated, these are the fake newsers out there. And then Biden flew. Think of it. He goes into a tough place. We just made such a great deal with China. Just think of this. My guy said, if we could get $20 billion in agricultural product, that would be good. The most China ever did was $16 billion for our farmers, okay? We're just talking about the farmers. We did banking, we did everything. But we're talking about them. The most they ever did was $20 billion of product from our farmers, our great farmers, our patriot farmers, our farmers that never left us even though they were being targeted by China. They never left me. So they wanted 20 and China agreed. And I said, nope, no good. I want 50 billion, not 20 billion. 50. So my guys say, sir, we have a problem, sir. Our farmers cannot produce that much. It's true. I said, tell them to go out and get bigger tractors, right? John Deere case, Caterpillar, all American, only American tractors. We only buy American tractors. Go out and get bigger. So now China's agreed that they've already started buying. Hopefully the agreement gets signed sometime prior to a big summit that we have with President Xi and others in Chile. So that's in about 4 weeks. But think of this. They said, sir, they can't produce $50 billion. I said, I want the farmers to tell me. Remember the story about winning? We're going to win so much. We're going to the White House. We're going to tell the president, sir, we just can't stand winning. The state of Texas, John Cornyn and Ted Cruz, they're going to come into my office. Sir, we just can't stand this winning in Texas anymore. It's too much. We can't handle it. Well, that's what I want from the farmers. I want the farmers to say, sir, we just can't produce that much product. We can't do it, sir. And I'm going to say, yes, you can. And they're going to say, no, we can't. I'm going to say, yes, you can. And they're going to go out and they're going to take in $50 billion from China as opposed to 20. That's what's going to happen. That's what's going to happen. But they were great. They stuck with us through thick and thin. Now it's really working out for a lot of different groups. And in the meantime, we've taken in tens of billions of dollars of tariffs, and China's eaten the cost because they devalued their currency and they put money out. Tens of billions of dollars. It's cost us nothing. Billions and billions and billions. And you know what I did for the farmer during the lean times? I gave them $16 billion last year and $12 billion the year before, $28 billion altogether, came out of the tariffs, and I had a lot of money left over. And nobody complained. And you know, our farmers didn't want that money. Our farmers didn't want it. True story. Everybody comes for money. Countries come for everybody wants money, right? They all want our money. The farmers said, sir, we don't want this money. It's a subsidy. We don't want it. I said, no, it's not a subsidy. You're being targeted unfairly. They said, no, sir, it's a subsidy. This is true. I had 35 farmers in the Oval Office. Incredible people. They didn't want it. They said, sir, just give us a level playing field. So now I gave them a field that's more than level. It's level like this. Nice and easy. Nice and easy. But the farmers, I call them the great patriots, the farmers. I never lost them. They always said, you know, yeah, I'm in trouble. I got a problem. But this should have been done many, many years ago by other presidents and other leaders. And we lose, for many years, $500 billion a year with China. And many other countries, we lose billions. We lose with everybody. But that's all changing now. But we lose $500 billion, not million. $500 million's a lot, right? We lose $500 billion. And you know what? It's a disgrace that that was allowed to go on for 25 years. It was a disgrace. Disgrace. But now we're taking in billions of dollars. They've had the worst year they've had in 27 years, and we're having the best year we've ever had, so that's good. That's good. So Biden flew with Hunter on Air Force Two. They flew to China. Hunter walked out of the plane at a quick meeting, walked away with $1.5 billion, and these characters back there said, oh, that's okay. There's no problem. Can you imagine if Don or Eric Trump or Ivanka Trump, who's here someplace, right here. And by the way, our great First Lady is home watching this. She said, this is the most exciting thing I've seen in a long time. She's a great First Lady, doing a great job. She's doing a great job. We're doing a great job. The whole country now is doing a great job. So Biden takes $1.5 billion. And he goes on and he allows China to rip us off. Remember he said a year ago, no, China's good. They've done nothing wrong. They're wonderful people. They are wonderful people. I don't blame China, by the way. I blame our leaders for allowing this horrible you-know-what and pillage. It's the R word. You-know-what and pillage. You know what word I'm talking about, right? I don't want to use it because they'll say it's a horrible word that Trump used. So the Bidens got rich while America got robbed. Tonight, we forcefully condemn the blatant corruption of the Democrat Party. And nobody ever pays the price with the Democrats. They're so deep-seated. They never pay the price. They never pay, but maybe soon that will start. You know, we've had a lot of Obama people and Clinton people and some, to be honest with you, we've had some pretty bad Republicans down deep that didn't exactly love us. But slowly they're getting out. They have all sorts of protections, but so he says, get rid of them. Yeah, we're trying. Get rid of them. But their partner in the whole thing is the fake news media. That's the problem. Because the Democrats and the fake news media, it's a partnership, remember that. And you see it all the time. And I've never seen it to this extent. You know, when I won in the primaries, and then I won the election, I was treated horribly by the media, horribly. And then when I won the election, we had the greatest night, one of the highest rated nights in the history of television all over the world. And I won and I said, oh, the great thing. I said to Ivanka, I said to the First Lady, I said to anybody that would listen, I said, listen, this is so great. Finally, finally, we, all of us, we're going to be respected by the media. And you know what happened? They got worse. They're worse now than they ever have been. They're crooked as hell. They're worse now than they've ever been. They're crooked. The only message these radicals, and they are radical lefties, will understand is a crushing defeat on November 3rd, 2020. Save that day. With your help, we will win back the House, we will keep the Senate, and we will keep the White House in numbers like they haven't seen in a long, long time. Joining us tonight are many terrific Republican leaders, and they are terrific. And frankly, if they're not, I'm not going to introduce them, okay? But we have some great leaders, and you have great leaders in Texas. Great leaders. And they love Texas. So a friend of mine, a guy that a lot of people weren't so sure, we had this unbelievable relationship. In fact, when Ted Cruz held a rally in Washington, he said, could you come to my rally? And everybody thought, these people thought, that was strange. They said to me, well, when is the fighting between these two? Because we really like each other. When's the fighting going to start? Right, Ted? They said, when is the fighting going to start? And I said, don't worry, it'll start. And when it does, it's going to be vicious. And it was vicious. And now we love each other again. He's great. Ted Cruz. And he had a great victory against a man that spent almost $100 million. That's a lot of money. Spent almost $100 million, but that was a great victory. Thank you, Ted. Another man who's currently running against somebody. I kept thinking maybe Beto will jump in because he's at zero right now. We hope he's going to jump in. Remember, no religion and no guns. I think that's not good. Oh, and I think he's, like, pretty light on oil production, too. But a man, and John, I have no idea who you're running against, but nobody's going to be able to beat John Cornyn. He's a good man. He's a good man. Thank you, John. And we have a lot of Congress people here. We have a woman who's fantastic, who's been a fan of ours right from the beginning, Kay Granger. Thank you, Kay. We have a man who's smart as hell, and he is tough, and he is mean and nasty, but he loves this state. And he's only mean and nasty because he wants to defend you and me and all of the horrible things that we all go through. Louie Gohmert. Louie. He's a great guy, been a great friend of mine. I'll tell you once we got him on board, he wouldn't leave us no matter what. And he had Mueller and everybody figured out long before anybody else had it figured out. Right, Louis? A person who's been an incredible ally, again, loves your state, Randy Weber. Thank you, Randy. Great job. Thank you. One of the best lawyers you'll ever find. He's slick, he's smooth, but boy, he's loyal, he's talented, and he's got them all buffaloed because they're not as good as him, John Ratliff. Thank you, Joe. A man I saw on television last night defending me, brilliantly defending me. I actually don't like doing this usually, but I tweeted out, I said, "Thank you very much, Brian Babin. That was a great defense. I appreciate it." Thank you, Brian. That was great last night. See, I put a tweet out because it's easier than making a phone call and talking for a half hour. Thanks, Brian. I just said, thanks. And you know what? He'd rather have that too, actually, right? And Lance Gooden, special person, Lance Gooden. Thank you, Lance. Thank you, Lance. And Lance was one of 60 people that stuck in there. He was unbelievable. And Ron Wright. Thank you, Ron. Great job. Great job. These are great people. These are great people, along with Republican Party chairs and all of these total winners. Here's one, Ronna McDaniel, I'll tell you what. You know, Ronna was the head of Michigan. Michigan hadn't been won by a Republican for decades, and it was tough. They all said you couldn't win Michigan. I said, why? We're getting these massive crowds. Why? And she was in charge of Michigan. And I said, I want you to do me a favor. Find out who this woman is. She's driving me crazy. She calls me just one more trip, sir. One more trip. Who is she? Who is she? And it was Ronna. And we won the state of Michigan. We won. And when it came time to picking somebody to head the RNC, Republican National Committee, I said, what about that woman that drove me crazy from Michigan? And it was Ronna, and she's done a fantastic job. Thank you. Thank you, Ronna. Thank you. She's fantastic. And a great governor from your state. He's a great, great man. And a friend of mine. And together with your Lieutenant Governor, Dan Patrick, I mean, you had a hurricane 2 years ago now. They still keep calling me for money. Sir, could you give us another one? The governor called up. Dan was there. You know, thank you for being so generous to Texas, sir. The hurricane, it was a big one. It was a bad one. A lot of water dump. I think the biggest dump of what, remember? Kept going in and out, in and out. Our Coast Guard saved 16,000 lives. Thank you. But it kept going in and out. Water, water. And finally, I get a call. I paid billions and billions of dollars to the state. Like numbers, my people are driving me crazy. I get a call from the governor, and Dan is there. Where's Dan? Is he here? Where's Dan? Dan. Dan Patrick. And the two of them call me. And then I had Ted Cruz on my back, and I had John Cornyn on my back, and I had the congressman calling, and it was brutal. It wasn't even fair. And they said, sir, thank you for being so generous on the hurricane. They made a fortune. You made a fortune on the hurricane. Thank you for being so generous, sir. Sir, we want one more small request. Just a small, it's not much, and we appreciate you listening to us. We want to build a dam in the ocean so that if we ever have another hurricane, sir, the water won't be able to come in to Houston and all of the areas that it came into, sir. Do you think we could do it? I said, how much? It's only $10 billion. $10 billion! Right, Ted? Right? $10 billion they wanted, Ted. And it, you know the way they sell it. And it's so good. They're salesmen. They're incredible salesmen. They say, it's only $10 billion. I'm supposed to be happy. Oh, let's see. Could we give Texas an extra $10 billion for some crazy thing that may work and it may not, right? No, they're great people. They love your state. RNC co-chairman Tommy Hicks, a real friend of ours. Thank you, Tommy. And our great campaign manager, the most sophisticated man with a computer you've ever seen. Remember, they used to say with Hillary, her campaign is so sophisticated. Then after she lost, they said Trump's campaign was so sophisticated. And remember, she spent like six times more on this stuff than we did. You know, in the old days, my father taught me, if you can spend less, that's a good thing, not a bad thing, right? My father said, if you can spend less. So we spent much less than Hillary. Crooked Hillary. Crooked Hillary. Where are those emails, Hillary? They may find those 33,000 emails. They're looking. They may find those deleted emails. They may find them. Remember the emails that 33,000 emails covering her gym and her daughter's wedding. 33,000, that's a lot of emails for a wedding and working out. But Brad Parscale did a great job. Thank you, Brad. Thank you. Thank you, Brad. And Secretary of Commerce, one of the legends of Wall Street, he was really, like, amazing, and he is doing an incredible job. Wilbur Ross. Thank you, Wilbur. Smart guy. And a friend of mine, he's another one. He was so tough. He was nasty, man. Boy, he hit me during the campaign. I said, that guy's ruthless. And when it was sort of over, there was nobody more gracious. And I called him. I made him Secretary of Energy. He's done a phenomenal job. And Rick Perry couldn't have done a better job. True, true. And he's going to be leaving at the end of the year and probably coming back here. Whatever he does, it's going to be successful. But he spent 3 years with us, and I want to thank you, Rick. What a job you've done. Thank you. What a job he's done. He was also a great governor of Texas, that you know. In everything we do, we're fighting for the faithful citizens of this country. This includes putting a stop to the catastrophic era of endless wars. Endless wars. They don't stop. They don't stop. They go on forever. We become policemen. we end up becoming police. We're policing these countries. That's not what it's about. We've spent $8 trillion in the Middle East. Thousands of American soldiers have lost their lives. Tens of thousands more have been severely wounded. And in all fairness, the other side has lost millions of people. Millions, millions of people. Think of it. These wars brought mass chaos, instability, destruction, and death. Today, we choose a different path. We had tremendous success today. I don't know if you've seen. Look, we built in the last 3 years, we built the strongest military by far. When I told the story, I was embarrassed to tell it, but now I'll tell. When I first got in, a general told me we could have had a conflict with someone, said, "Sir, we don't have ammunition." And I said, "I never want to hear a president. I just never want to hear somebody have that statement made to them again as president of the United States. We don't have ammunition." Think of how bad. Now we have so much ammunition, we don't know what to do with it. And as you all know, I guess you've been watching today, I sent Vice President Pence and Secretary of State Pompeo to lead an American delegation to meet with President Erdogan of Turkey. They got there today, and it did work. Without spilling a drop of American blood, not one drop of American blood, we've all agreed on a pause or a ceasefire in the border region of Syria. And it was unconventional what I did. I said, they're going to have to fight a little while. Sometimes you have to let them fight a little while. Then people find out how tough the fighting is. These guys know right up here. These guys know. Right? Sometimes you have to let them fight. It's like two kids in a lot. You got to let them fight, and then you pull them apart. But it was unconventional. But they fought for a few days, and it was pretty vicious. And the Kurds, who are our friends, and Turkey's our friend. But they fought. It was tougher. I mean, it was nasty. And you couldn't make a deal for 15, think of it, for 15 years, 20 years, they couldn't make a deal. The Kurds didn't want to move. Turkey didn't want to budge. And Turkey was having a lot of bad things happen from this region, in all fairness to Turkey. They were having a lot of bad, but they didn't want to. Now all of a sudden they're fighting, and it's not fun having bullets going all over the place. And we went there, and we said, we want to pause. And the Kurds have been terrific. They're going to move back a little bit. We're going to keep ISIS all nice and locked up, okay? We're going to find more of them. And Turkey's all set, and President Erdogan was great, and we're going to take the worst sanctions and tariffs and everything that I put on the country. We put the worst. I mean, I don't think they could have economically survived, but that doesn't matter. President Erdogan was a gentleman. He understood it. But without a little tough love, you know what tough love is, right? Without a little tough love, they would have never made this deal. President Obama lost a million people in the area. A million people. A million people. So now we're doing a, during a five-day period, we're going to see if we can get it all finalized. And I think it will be. I think it will be. So Turkey's going to be happy. The Kurds are going to be happy. ISIS is going to be unhappy. We'll deal with whoever we have to deal with, but we'll get it done, and it's a great tribute to a lot of very talented people. And thank you to Vice President Pence, and thank you to Mike Pompeo. Good job. Good job. And they're traveling back to our country by night. They're traveling back, and they'll be back soon, and we'll have a big conference on it. But it was a terrific thing, and we've taken care of a lot of religious persecution. We added that in. A lot of things are in that agreement that nobody ever thought possible. So we have to fundamentally change our approach to homeland security. As an example, in that example, nobody would have ever done that. You have to be a little bit different to do it that way. I took a lot of heat, even from some of our congressmen, even from some of our senators, but now they're all happy, and I'm happy with them. I'm happy with them. Now, I don't know what about the Democrats. The Democrats will say, oh, what a terrible. Anything we do, the Democrats will criticize. If I said, like on the China deal, we get Beijing for $1, they would say, what a terrible deal. It just doesn't work with them. You know, the wall, we spent so much time with them on the wall. And I realized about 2 weeks ago, all I had to do was say, we will never build the wall. And they would have come through and they said, we demand that you build it. It would have been so much easier. Right? Would have been so much easier, Ted. Would have been so much easier. American combat troops should not be at the center of ancient sectarian conflicts all over the world. Bring our soldiers back home. Bring our soldiers back home. The same people pushing us to fight endless wars overseas want us to open our borders to mass migration from these war-torn and terror-afflicted regions. Their policies would import terrorism right onto our shores with American-issued visas. Oh, isn't that wonderful? And by the way, the Democrats want open borders. They want everybody to flow in. They want those caravans to flow in. The caravans. And they wouldn't get rid of the loopholes, but you know what? Mexico's been great. Mexico today had 27,000 soldiers on our border. And we've stopped this horrible migration of people. And many of them are bad people. You know, when countries send them up, they're not sending their finest, okay? Use your heads. They're not sending their finest. You got to see some of the people. But now we send them back. And by the way, ICE is fantastic. They've taken out thousands and thousands of MS-13 killers. They've taken thousands of killers and brought them back. And now we've made deals with Guatemala and Honduras and El Salvador and Mexico. But we've made deals now where we can bring back. There are 45,000 people waiting in Mexico, but it's going to be very tough for these people ever to get back. When did you ever hear that? You used to have no people waiting in Mexico. They just flood. Our borders are getting strong. When the wall is complete, they'll be as strong as any borders anywhere in the world. My administration believes in a simple principle. The best way to keep foreign terrorists out of America is deny them, just deny them, admission in the first place. It's really pretty simple. And that is why I've imposed, and we had passed, and we won at the United States Supreme Court, a travel ban on some of the world's most dangerous countries and places. But if Democrats seized power, they would throw the floodgates wide open, wide open. We would have people coming into our country. Look at what's going on in California, and the people of California don't want it. They say, come into California. We'll give you free health care, free education. Why wouldn't? I may even move to California if they keep going. No, but all it does is it brings everybody in. What's wrong with these people? We're rebuilding our military stronger than ever before, and we are not going to deplete it again on stupid, senseless, endless wars. We've invested more than $2.5 trillion restoring our armed forces, and all of it was built in the USA. And that includes approving the construction of almost 200 F-35 fighters, stealth, stealth. And many of them are built right here, right here. You know that, right? In Fort Worth. As we restore our security, we're also restoring our prosperity. America is winning again, and America is respected again. And by the way, I have to say this. So outside, they have close to 30,000 people. And I wonder if I could ask the fire marshal, fill up this little area, let him in. Be so nice. You know, they have a certain max. We broke the record tonight. Good place. Last month, unemployment reached its lowest level in 51 years. 7 million Americans have been lifted off food stamps since the election. What a great. 1.3 million children have been lifted out of poverty. Think of that. And African American, Hispanic American, and Asian American unemployment rates have reached the lowest levels in history. Our great Hispanic American population has reached a poverty level which is a all-time low in U.S. history. And after years of stagnation, wages for Hispanic Americans are rising fast, up nearly 8% since my election, and everybody in the fake news would have said, that's absolutely impossible. Medium income, think of this, median income for Hispanic Americans has surpassed $50,000 a year for the first time ever. With Republicans in Congress, we passed the largest package of tax cuts and reform by far in American history. By the way, the Democrats want to raise your taxes, you know. I don't mean a little bit. I don't mean a little bit. I mean like double them up, triple them up, and it still won't pay for the nonsense they want. We eliminated a record number of regulations, and we ended the war on a thing called American energy, which is very good for Texas. Since my election, natural gas production in Texas has increased 35%, and oil production has increased by 60%, 6-0. And the United States is now the number one producer of oil and natural gas anywhere in the world. World. Yet every major Democrat running for president wants to abolish all production of oil and natural gas. I think they want to go to windmills. Windmills, you know? Darling, I want to watch Trump speak tonight. We can't, darling. The wind isn't blowing. They want windmills. In other words, they want to annihilate your Texas economy. Can you imagine? No more oil, no more natural. So here we have a few people, right? No guns, no religion, no oil, no natural gas. Abraham Lincoln could not win Texas under those circumstances. Couldn't do it. Couldn't do it, Ted. Couldn't do it, Louis. Abraham Lincoln, honest Abe, couldn't do it, Louis, right? Remember, I used to say, I can be more presidential. Look. I've always said I can be more presidential than any president in history, except for Honest Abe Lincoln when he's wearing the hat. That's tough. That's tough. That's a tough one to be. No, it's much easier. Being presidential is easy. All you have to do is act like a stiff. Look. Ladies and gentlemen of Texas, it is a great honor to be with you this evening. And the media would love it, and everybody would be out of here so fast. You wouldn't have come in the first place when you get right down to it. But Democrats will never get that chance because Texas will never give it to them. Texas is not good. Remember in the last election, they said, these phonies in the back, they said, Texas is in play. They said Utah's in play, too. And I came here, we had rallies like this, thousands of people outside that couldn't get in. And I said, why is Texas in play? They say, because it's phony, it's suppression. They try and get your hopes down. They're suppressing. This is just like fake news. But they said Texas. They said Texas is in play. Ladies and gentlemen, Texas is in play. This is CNN. Texas is in play. President Trump. And I had guys on from Texas, and they're wearing cowboy hats. Sid and a lot of guys. They go, I don't know about you, but I know something about Texas. And Donald Trump is not going to lose Texas, I can tell you that. And Texas is not in play. And, no, we had a lot of guys. Sid. Big, tough guys. They're on television. No, I don't know what you're talking about. Texas is not in play. And then that great November 8th, we had that great, great night. And the polls closed at 7 o'clock. And usually they have to take hours and, you know, sometimes at least, even if it's big, they take a half an hour. The Texas polls have closed, and you know, usually if it's close, it takes hours. And if it's not even just like so close, it takes a long time. So they go, ladies and gentlemen, the polls have closed in the state of Texas. Donald Trump has won the state of Texas. Right? Donald Trump. The polls have closed in Utah. Remember the guy with the shaved head? He was going to be my competition. Even Hillary beat him. Now he's on these talk shows knocking the hell out of me all the time. No, even Hillary beat this guy in Utah, right? Hillary came in second. I came in first by a lot, but that was another one. Too close to call. Except, ladies and gentlemen, Utah, the polls have closed. Donald Trump has won the state of Utah. It is in the same state. And we won by a lot. We won by a lot. And we won Florida, and we won South Carolina, and we won Georgia, and we won North Carolina, and we won Pennsylvania. We won a lot. Remember these phony people? There is no way to get to 270. You had to get to 270. So I kept going to Maine. I love Maine. But Maine 2, you get one. It's cut in half. Maine 2, you get one. I went there 4 or 5 times because they got me up, the phonies, they got me up to 269, couldn't get to 270. So I went there. I won, by the way. I won Maine 2. I got one. But I went there, and I went there a lot. That's the beautiful thing about the Electoral College. You go everywhere. You don't just spend it 3. And, you know, winning the popular vote would be much easier. I'd rather have that. I'd go to 4 states and relax. I went to 21 states. Good. Good. I used to be a believer in the other, but I think winning the — it's like you're a track star. You're working out for the 100-yard dash or the mile. It's a different form of training. It's a different form. But we did great. They said, he cannot get to 270. And they were right. We got to 306. After decades of economic surrender, I have taken historic action to confront China's rampant trading abuses, and we've made great progress. And our relationship with China is fantastic, and great things are happening. You watch. They get it now. They get it, and a lot of good things are happening. We're replacing NAFTA with disastrous. I mean, it's been, to me, probably, I used to call it the worst trade deal in history. I think the world trade has been WTO, one of real beauty, World Trade Organization. That's a real beauty. They consider China a developing nation. And because you're a developing nation, Ted, right? They consider China to be a developing nation. And because they're developing, they get tremendous. And we wrote them letters. We don't consider them to be a developing nation. We don't consider India to be a developed, because they're ripping us off. And we didn't win any cases at the WTO, and now we just won $7.5 billion of countries that we're taking advantage of. And we've won a lot of cases lately. We didn't win anything for years, practically. Now we've won a lot of cases. You know why? Because they know I'll leave if they don't treat us fairly. They know it. And then the piggy bank is gone, where they all rob from. We're replacing the NAFTA disaster, and we have to get this crazy Nancy Pelosi to put this thing up for a vote. We have to get her. And the USMCA is a giant victory for Texas farmers, ranchers, manufacturers, workers, and oil. The Democrats should pass it. Overwhelmingly, they will. But Nancy has to put it up for a vote. Do nothing, Democrats. They do nothing. Nowhere is the Democrat betrayal of our nation more dramatic than on immigration. In recent debates, did you see these debates? You believe what I'm competing with? I don't know. When I had to compete with Ted Cruz, that was brutal. You know, he was the national debate champion. Story I've never told. I never did that before, right? I ran for office. All of a sudden, I'm supposed to be debating tomorrow night. I said, who are these people? The hell, I don't know all of them. I know a lot of them. I contributed to a lot of them. They used to treat me very nice when I contributed to them. Not so nice when I was their opponent. It changed a lot. But I said, let me see. I want to see who are these people. I'm going to a debate. I never debated. My whole life has been a debate, but I never debated like with a podium and this and that. So I said, who are they? And we had 17 people plus me. We had 18. It was actually not 17. It was 18. Remember Gilmore? Nobody remembers him. But we had 18 people. I said, who are these people? Are they any good at debating? And I hired a debate coach, and he lasted for about 10 minutes. I said, this guy knows less than I do. He didn't know anything. He didn't know anything. It's true. He said, never, ever interrupt while they're speaking. I said, okay, coach, put me in, coach. And after a couple of those statements, I mean, you can't beat Ted Cruz if you don't interrupt him. It's impossible. But my first, it's true. So I see, let me see the cards. Let me see the whole thing. I want to see it. I need help. I'm going to be debating in front of millions of people. And everyone's saying, do you think Trump's going to be able to debate professionally? I said, let me see these cards. And all of them, you know, he was president of his class. One guy was a good debater in college. He was this. He was okay. But they give me the first card, Ted Cruz. And it says, national debate champion from Princeton. Is that right? And then national debate champion from Harvard. I said to my wife, first lady, potentially. I said, my potential first lady, I got a problem. I said, some of these guys are okay. They were only president of the class. Almost all of them ran for president of the class. I never did. I like playing baseball better. But I said, Melania, and I called Ivanka. I called my kids. I said, I got a problem. Ted Cruz was the national debate. He was the number one guy in college. He was the number one guy in law school. How the hell do I beat a guy that's that good at debating? But we came out okay, Ted. And Ted was tough. Smart as hell and tough. Tough! Good man. But it is true. The first card I looked at, seriously, was Ted Cruz, and he was literally, I mean, national debate. He was the best in all of college and in law school. And he's a talented guy. In recent debates, you see these people up there. They're not Ted Cruz, believe me. Hey, Ted, you should turn Democrat. You would win in that group, very. No? He says. I don't think so. Every single Democrat candidate for president raised their hand in favor of giving free health care to all illegal aliens. They want to give more to illegal aliens than they give to American citizens. You see that? As president, I will never allow the Democrats to take away your health care dollars and give them to people that are in our country illegally. Can't do it. In fact, I just signed an executive action to protect American health care benefits for all American citizens. Among those hardest hit by illegal immigration are millions of legal immigrants right here in Texas, including millions of patriotic, hardworking Mexican-Americans who play by the rules, pay their taxes, follow our laws, and strengthen our communities. Whether you are a first generation or 10th generation, and every American citizen, and you do, you've been treated so badly, but you're not being treated badly anymore, you know? We got rid of the individual mandate from crazy Obamacare. Every American citizen deserves a government that defends your jobs, your safety, your family, your borders, and is always loyal to you for a change. We're loyal to you. My administration has reduced illegal border crossings by over 60% since May, and that's with no help from the Democrats. They won't close up the loopholes. They won't close the loopholes, and we could do it in 15 minutes. And we're building the wall, and we're doing all of these things, but the Democrats won't close up the loopholes. You know what the loopholes are, right? How about catch and release? You catch them. You say, hello, darling, how are you? Could you please give us your name and phone number? They don't have a phone. Could you give us your address? They don't want to have an address that's in Honduras. Could you please give us your address and your name? They can't. They said, that's okay. We catch and we release. And they go into our country. And then we are getting them out of the country. And you know what? Some are very good people. Some are unbelievably dangerous and bad people. And we're focusing on the bad, and they're getting the hell out of our country, okay? While we're fighting for shared priorities, the American people, the Democrat Party, has never been farther outside of the mainstream. They've gone nuts. Every Democrat running for president is pushing a health care agenda that would utterly eviscerate Medicare. My administration will always protect Medicare for our beloved seniors, and we will always protect patients with pre-existing conditions. Our ambitious campaign to reduce the price of prescription drugs has produced the largest decline in drug prices in over 51 years. People don't talk about it. The press will not talk about it. We have news conferences. We tell them this. They will not put it in the press. You have no idea how dishonest the media is. You have no idea. Virtually every top Democrat also now supports late-term abortion, ripping babies straight from the mother's womb right up until the moment of birth. and that crackpot governor from Virginia executes the baby after birth. You saw that, right? After birth. You remember that one from last year. That's why I've asked Congress to prohibit extreme late-term abortion, because Republicans believe that every child is a sacred gift from God. Democrats are now the party of crazy politicians, high taxes, high crime, open borders, late-term abortion, socialism, and blatant corruption. They're corrupt, like Schiff is corrupt. He's corrupt. The Republican Party is the party of the American worker, the American family, and it's the party of the American dream. It's also the party of honest Abe Lincoln. We forget that. We gotta use that more often, don't you think? You know, honest Abe. I like honest Abe. We've confirmed. He says, honest Donald, thank you. Explain that to them. You're right. We've confirmed 152 federal judges to apply the laws written, including two Supreme Court justices, Neil Gorsuch and Brett Kavanaugh. You know, when I got into office, they say the most important thing a president can do, I actually think it's defense. But they say is the appointment of federal judges. So when I got in, always when you get in, there are none. How many do you have? I have none. None. So I got in and say, how many federal judges do I have? Sir, you have 142 federal judges. No, you don't understand the question. That's impossible. That would mean that President Obama didn't appoint 142 judges. You get none. Or you're doing a bad job as president because you're representing a different philosophy, very different. So I came, I said, no, check it again. Then they said 138, then they came back, actually, sir, the number is 142. We were right the first time. 142 judges. Within 2 months, we will have John and Ted and all of these great congressmen, we will have passed 182 federal judges. And then they say, Obama, wasn't he such a wonderful president? How are you a wonderful president? How are you a wonderful president when the most important thing you can do, you hand it over to the Republicans, 142? How is that good? I mean, how is that good? If I were a Democrat, I wouldn't be too happy about that number. And we'll have a record number of judges. By the time our term is over in 16 years, maybe 20. I'm only kidding. I'm only kidding, because every time I do that, they say, see, he's assuming control. We have this crazy guy on television, and he goes, you know, he's talking to a guest. He goes, you know he's going to win, don't you? You know he's going to win. I mean, we've done a good job. He should be happy. But he said, our military, our schools, our this, everything. He says, you know he's going to win. And the guest goes, well, no, well, we're going to fight. No, no, he's going to win. And you know, he's never leaving. You know that, don't you? He's never leaving. He's never going to leave. And I thought this wacko was kidding. You know, he's a comedian. I thought he was kidding. He's serious. He really believes it. We passed for the veterans, VA choice and VA accountability on behalf of those great people. They've been trying to pass it for almost 50 years. They couldn't get it done. But those guys right there and me, we got it done. And to protect America's security, I withdrew the United States from the horrible, one-sided Iran nuclear deal. I recognized Israel's true capital and opened the American embassy in Jerusalem. And we also recognized Israeli sovereignty over the Golan Heights. For years, you watched as your politicians apologized for America. You've seen it many times. Oh, I'm so sorry. Now you have a president who's standing up for America and standing up for your great state of Texas. You must never forget the 2020 election is about one thing, and it's coming up fast. It's about you. It's about you. One thing about you. I'm doing this for you. You know, we had in 2016, I really believe it was maybe the greatest election. I guess George Washington was good, right? But that was easy. And by the way, he did even better percentage-wise in judges than I did. He had 100%. But we could have 50%. That's not bad. And I had many more than he had. So I guess you got to give George Washington. What do you think, Ted? You got to give him something. I'd say Honest Abe, that was a pretty good election, right? Andrew Jackson, they say ours topped Andrew Jackson. But Andrew Jackson was a good election. But we had among the greatest elections of all time. But we have to now cement that election, got to cement it. And once we do, it's going to be very hard to take this beautiful experiment apart. It's going to be very hard. Because it's all about your family, it's all about your future, and it's all about the future fate of our great country. So important. With your help, we will lift millions of more citizens from welfare to work, dependence to independence, and poverty to prosperity. Together, we will elect a Republican Congress to create a safe, modern, fair, and lawful system of immigration. And by the way, thank you, Robert Jeffress, for being here, wherever you may be in this massive... Wherever you are, Robert, where is he? He got up, he started saying, he may not be the greatest person. I said, this is like 4 years ago. I see this guy, what a mouthpiece he's got. And he's a man of God. And he said, he may not be the greatest. He may not be the most perfect Christian. He may not know the Bible as well as some of us, but he's a leader. And I love Donald Trump. I said, who is that guy? I love that guy. Robert Jeffress. He's a great guy. Got a big, big group of people on Sunday mornings, too, I can tell you. We will enact trade deals that result in more products proudly stamped with those beautiful words, that beautiful phrase, I love it, made in the USA. We will achieve new breakthroughs in science and medicine, finding new cures for childhood cancer, and ending the AIDS epidemic in America in less than 10 years. We're doing that. Who would have believed we could do that? We're doing that. And the previous administration spent no money on that, and we're spending a lot. But think of that. Who would have thought that? We're going to end, within 10 years, the AIDS epidemic in our country. Who would have thought we've advanced that? We will defend privacy, free speech, free assembly, religious liberty, and the right to keep and bear arms. Above all, we will never stop fighting for the values that unite people all across our land and throughout the great state of Texas. This is a great state. We support, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. We stand with the incredible heroes of law enforcement. Thank you. We believe in the dignity of work and the sanctity of life. We believe that faith and family, not government and bureaucracy, are the true bedrocks of our society. We believe in the creeds of self-reliance, personal responsibility, and American independence. We believe that children should be taught to love our country, honor our history, and always respect our great American flag. Loyal citizens like you help build this country, and together we are taking back this country, our country. We love our country. We're returning power to you, the American people. That's what we've done. From Dallas to El Paso, from Houston to Austin, from the Red River to the Rio Grande, this state was settled by some of the toughest men and strongest women ever to walk on the face of the earth, Texas. This is the state where William Travis, James Bowie, and Davy Crockett made their last stand at the Alamo. This is the state where a small band of patriots at the Battle of Gonzales, armed with a single cannon, stared down a foreign army and declared, "Come and take it." And Texas is the state where generations of farmers, ranchers, pioneers, and oil workers built a life and a home with their own two beautiful hands. They didn't have a lot of money. They didn't have a lot of luxury. But they all had one thing in common. They loved their families, they loved their country, and they loved their God. These courageous Texas patriots did not shed their blood, sweat, and tears so that we could sit at home while others tried to erase their legacy, demolish our liberty, and destroy our proud American heritage. We will never, ever allow that to happen. With your help, your devotion, and your drive, we are going to keep on working, we are going to keep on fighting, and we are going to keep on winning, winning, winning. We are one movement, one people, one family, and one glorious nation under God. And together, we will make America wealthy again. We will make America proud again. We will make America strong again. We will make America safe again. And we will make America great again. Thank you, Texas. Thank you.